Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, especially dear colleagues from Latvia who organized this event, and thank you for inviting me here. When already your Minister of Culture and the previous speaker representing the Directorate General for Translation mentioned the legal and the political commitment of the European Union to linguistic diversity and cultural diversity, we often tend to take this for granted. Yeah? We often, although it hasn't been that long, but we shouldn't forget what the European Union is trying to do here to work with 23, soon 25, official languages and more than 40 languages whose rights are also guaranteed, and to provide then with 25 languages even 600 translation pairs, and to keep them all alive and give them equal rights is an unprecedented experiment. That has never happened in the history of mankind before. All superpowers of the world in the past and at other places of the world have one dominating language. Yeah? And what the European Union, what we are trying here is something of which we don't know whether it will fly. We don't know whether it will fly, whether it will be affordable in the end, and whether all these languages can survive in the digital age. In general, we have about 6,000 languages in the world, but 4,000 of them are probably doomed to extinction. And that is even a very optimistic statement, because many of my colleagues who are doing research in this field and who have observed the indications for at least language death in the public sphere think that only a few hundred languages will survive of the 6,000. So, and one core component of the common market goes even further than saying that all these languages will stay and will have equal status in society. The digital agenda of the European Union even calls for a single common market and a single information space. So one information space that caters all the citizens of the European Union. That means not only the languages will be have to be there, but there has to be information shipped around. And right now this doesn't work, because our last remaining borders in the European Union, after we have opened the borders for people and finances and goods, are language boundaries. Are these language boundaries? And already today, if you talk about participatory democracy, about people participating in decision making, yeah, by the informed citizen, the informed citizens talk to each other about decisions like the Fukushima accident, energy policies, financial crisis, but they only talk to people who speak the same language. Yeah? There's no democratic discussion across the borders. Yeah? So these language boundaries are really staying with us until something has been done about it. Sometimes technology is blamed for playing a role in endangering languages, and in a way, indirectly, it does, because information technology furthers globalization, internationalization at a rapid speed. But on the other hand, technology also offers a solution, yeah, also with language technology, and that should be the topic of that talk, yeah, so that we are not part of the problem, but seen as part, or maybe a central part, of the solution. So, the major challenges that language technology is faced with are the following three. One is preserving the cultural and linguistic diversity of Europe in the United Information and Knowledge Society. And the second one is securing at an affordable cost this common information space, the free flow of information and thought across language boundaries. And the third one, also very, very important, is providing each language community with the most advanced technologies so that speaking their own language, holding on to their mother tongue, in the end is not going to turn into an economic disadvantage. Yeah? That the kids, the children, growing up speaking mother tongues other than the belonging to the big languages have exactly the same chances in the globalized society. And language technology is already there around us, but we are very bad in branding it. Yeah, so it is there in many. It is there, but we don't call it language technology in many cases. So there are spell and grammar checkers, such as Tilda is involved in, that was mentioned earlier, yeah, with Microsoft. Voice dialing on the cell phone, web search in Google, speech generation, computer-assisted language learning, even optical character recognition needs highly informed language-savvy technologies for finding errors, semantic text classification, speech control in cars, and so on. So, and during the last 18 months, we have seen quite some development. After 50 years of research in which, to us as the participants of this research, not for me, not 50 years, but longer than you think, then we've participated in, there was lots of frustration during that time, yeah, because things were going very slow. So we were hoping that applications would enter the market that we could really help. But in the last 1.5 years, there were quite a number of incidents that really gave a push to our field. So, for instance, the IBM Watson, yeah, that gained international recognition. They won a nationally broadcast TV quiz in the United States against the best quiz champions. Yeah, and Siri, a rather imperfect speech system, but nevertheless helpful. Yeah, was put on the iPhone. And Google introduced semantic search with a knowledge graph, and without telling people too much, is doing more and more semantics and calling their search division now knowledge. And Google Translator with 57 languages is very, very important, but still very imperfect. Yeah? If you've tried to translate from English to Latvian, you may still be lucky and only have a few laughs, yeah, during a text, but if you tried the same thing with Japanese to Latvian, then it's already much worse. So, but all large IT corporations and the European Union, and so they are trying to employ translation technology, and they have all installed it. And actually, we are very proud that some of the technology that the EU system that was mentioned is built on was developed in EU-funded research projects, which some of you even participated in. Yeah, so those were projects that. That fed into this technology. It all looks very good, but if you really look at what the software is doing, why people are already paying billions for companies, it is very imperfect. It's just the beginning. Yeah, it's still not very good. So we think that, for instance, if IBM Watson wins against the best quiz champions, it's a little bit like thinking that you have achieved artificial intelligence if artificial intelligence can beat the world champion in chess, yeah? But it cannot mimic a two-year-old child. And the same thing we have basically in language technology. On the one hand, we can beat the world champion in a few sophisticated questions, but we don't have a system that can translate one page without errors, yeah? or that can get semantics out of two sentences of a simple fairy tale that every kid can understand. So that is really interesting. So we are at the beginning, and still, even with very imperfect technology, there's already a market. Now assume if this technology improves at the stage, at the pace that we are hoping to improve it, then the markets will be much, much larger. So, because language technology is a key enabling technology, most of the leaders in information technology, if you read now their speeches, they agree that the next generation of information technology will have to deal with human knowledge, with human language and emotion in much more intelligent ways than it does today. So the idea is not anymore so much to mimic the human, because we've given up, not given up, but most of the people don't do that, that we can be much more helpful in extending the cognitive capabilities of the human, yeah? Because no human could translate into 57 languages, yeah? No human could within a few seconds search through millions of pages and find out semantically relevant information. So, but we can do some things that the machines cannot do. So having a nice fit will be the core of next generation technology. That's why we call it a key enabling technology. Language technology will not only help us to overcome communication barriers between people and between people and technology, and since computers are everywhere, not just computers, but all kinds of technology, yeah? Robots, other machines, yeah? Building machines. And language technology will help us to deal with this huge amount of digitized knowledge, yeah? All the digitized knowledge and information, creative content that is being added every day. So the future internet And the web will have to be multilingual, yeah? Otherwise they won't serve their intended purpose, namely serving the information needs of every citizen on the world. Yeah? And especially in the European environment that we don't need to stress anymore in more detail, there's a growing need because of the commitment to the many languages and all these. I don't have to repeat what the previous speakers told us about the mass of information. And there are huge markets behind it, yeah? And I won't bother you now with numbers, but the numbers, the translation and language service providers area, it has a much higher growth rate, yeah, 10 to 13%, much higher than the general economy. The general economy is sometimes stalling, yeah, but this area is it's growing at very modest portions right now, but this area is really growing very, very fast. That shows the importance of information for the people. And so we cannot say the markets are endless, yeah, because there's an end to the size of our world, but the future markets for language technology are limited by the number of people on Earth, yeah? And the number of their devices that they have, yeah? So it's quite a big market. So the demand is growing fast because of globalization, explosion of knowledge, and spread of advanced technologies to all areas of life. And European language technology is actually very strong. And in research, we are competing successfully. Not yet, as you all are aware of, not yet in commercialization always, yeah, because many of the big companies are European. We have many, many companies in Europe, hundreds of them, but they are small. Yeah, they are smaller companies, so they need different mechanisms for getting their highly specialized and valuable services to the people. But considering the number and complexity of our many languages, research is still much too slow. Yeah, language industry is big, but it's very fragmented, as I just mentioned, and Europe has this demand. So, but the main figures sometimes behind international progress, so if you look, for instance, at Google Translate, this group was actually started by one of my graduates, and then he hired a graduate from Germany, from Aachen, yeah, from Franz Och, and they hired more people, and half of the group is European there, yeah, so they're all Europeans. And the people who organize the localization world and who publish multilingual and all these, many of them are European, in the United States, all over the world, yeah. The person doing Asia online, yeah, translating in Asia from Bangkok, there's a European. So many, many Europeans there. So our people are strong, yeah, our people, we have very good research, but we have right now migration of talent, and we have to do something so to make sure that Europe is benefiting both on the user and on the provider side. But LT research is not as it should be, yeah? So now some of you are maybe working even in research. I don't want to put any blame on you. People are trying as hard as they can. But in general, our field is pretty much underfunded and underrepresented. So how do we know this? You saw when you came in the language white papers, yeah? You saw the white papers on 30 European languages. And please have a look at them, and there will be some special session on them, so I will make it very short. Yeah, there's one on the Latvian language that I hope you all received, but there are 29 others on other languages. And if we go through now we calibrated all the results, we talked about it, we had a special meeting in Berlin with all these people that you see on that picture here, yeah? And there was a fierce discussion. Oh, some of you were there, I recognize some faces, some of you were there. And fierce discussion, because at first hand, yeah, everybody, even from the small country, the people said, no, we are doing very good research, we have terrific technology, yeah? But really, if you are honest and if you compare it, even if people do wonderful work, have very, very good products, yeah, but if they compare the technological base and the data and the resources with the big languages, they simply cannot compete, yeah? They can, even if they work 24 hours a day, if you did, yeah? You cannot, because the field is not supported well enough. So when we compared the languages with respect to their support in machine translation, speech processing, in text analysis and language resources, when we grouped them, the languages as to how well they are supported, we came up that for a number of languages, there is weak or no support. Now, how can you say that if you have a successful company of Tilde, and we all have, I even downloaded when I came here the Tilde translator to be not lost in the city, and I like it very much. So it's very good technology, but if you look in general, if you compare it with English, I show you some numbers in a moment, we cannot compete, or even with Chinese, it doesn't work. So there's not enough support. So the observation is LT support for English is ahead of other language. Not even that is being perfect, clearly not. It has to be improved. You just look at some English grammar checker and then you know why. But the gap between English and the other languages keeps widening. And that is the dangerous thing. So take, for instance, this thing here. Take, for instance, this graph. That is now the four most important, the most prestigious places where language technology people publish. The Journal of Computational Linguistics and the three main conferences. So we took the about 2,000 papers of 3 years of there, 2008 to 2010, and we looked on what languages did they publish, what languages did they work on, and half of them were in English, as you can see. Half of them were in English, and then you get maybe more than 200 papers on Chinese. Then you get already the big drop. Then you get a few languages like German, Spanish, Arabic, and so, and then it drops again to 38 for Dutch, and then for many languages there's not just one paper, and for others there's no paper, So during these 3 years, there was no paper on Latvian, for instance. Sorry, it was not there. And maybe in another 3 years there is one, but in these 3 years there was no. And in other journals probably, but I took just the four most prestigious. So this cannot go on, otherwise the gap will really become much wider. So in order to get better funding, we have to bring together the main actors from industry and from research and define a common research program. Otherwise, if we just say we need more money, danger, danger, if you call fire and nobody knows how to extinguish the fire, then it doesn't really work. So we need to have a believable, a plausible, a respectable program, a well thought through program. And for that, we started the MetaNet, the Multilingual Europe Technology Alliance, but a network of excellence building this alliance. And this has now 60 research centers. Also in Latvia, also in Lithuania, in 34 countries actually. And one of the goals is building a community with a shared vision and strategic research agenda. Another one is building an infrastructure for sharing resources. You will hear more about it later from Stelios. And also doing research in selected fields and building bridges to other areas. And now we have these 60 centers, and we have built the alliance with 638 members, about 200 companies, close to 200 companies among them in 47 countries. We had a vision process, we had the language white papers, and now we have a research agenda. And it's near to completion, and I will say something about the priority themes before I finish this little talk. So there were three priority areas chosen. One is everything that has to do with translation. It's still called translation cloud, but it will have to go beyond the single cloud. We may call it translation sky or translation something. It has to be, so because translation cloud we already have. We even have a company that's called that way. We cannot call it that way anymore. We will be sued. But the idea being providing at least for Europe and maybe beyond a service on the web that gets that allows companies and research and public services to participate and to provide the best possible and the most affordable, and also cheaper and less expensive and more expensive technologies for immediate translation anywhere, anytime. And the second area is more about making the technology able to deal with knowledge and information. to allow decision making, text analytics, and there we picked, and we as hundreds of people participating here, we picked the area that we call social intelligence, not just having business intelligence, that's one part, yeah? Getting better informed business decisions by text analytics, monitoring social media, monitoring news, technology, and so on, but also getting decision makers in other areas, yeah? Politicians, educators, even medical people, yeah? Allowing them to make more informed decisions on the basis of what all the people are talking about and doing and thinking, yeah, and wanting, but also allowing the citizens, the customers, the patients, the students, yeah, the stakeholders in decisions, allowing them to participate in decision making on the social level, debating issues across language boundaries, yeah, across social boundaries, yeah, participate in that, being informed. So that, and the third is now the super theory. Yeah, the third area is the socially and emotionally aware and so on, socially aware digital assistant, yeah, that you have maybe not on your on a heavy iPhone anymore, maybe in your ear, on a little piece of jewelry with you, or maybe in the air around you, who knows, yeah, in the future. So the to make sure, why is there, and for this program, we need a mixture of science fiction. Without science fiction, yeah, you cannot get money for a program that should last until 2020, because otherwise you fall short of the promises of the big companies. Yeah? The big companies are also not lazy in making big promises. Yeah? So you need, but you need also a realistic path. You need also realistic steps in between that help companies and the citizens, because otherwise they lose faith in it. Yeah? So you need both the science fiction and a path that already guarantees commercially, socially valuable spin-offs within the next years. So those are the three areas, and they're of course intertwined, yeah, because the social intelligence needs translation, yeah, for multilingual debate and for cross-lingual decision making. And the also the socially aware interactive assistant, yeah, needs translation because it needs to interact with others. So all of these fields interact very much, and then there's a field of shared technologies in the center. And one of the interesting visions is ambient translation. Here you see ambient translation. You see it, yeah? You can easily see, yeah, here by color, that everybody speaks a different language here, and they nevertheless understand each other, yeah? With acoustic directed technology, yeah, and with microphones being picked up, you see they speak all different languages, yeah? The colors are the languages, as you could see. And here this meeting is extended now to a virtual meeting, not only people in the same room, but also people at different places. They talk, they understand each other, but each of them speak a different language. Yeah? So this meeting in 2020, then we will not have the headphones anymore, yeah? We will just sit there and all speak in our languages. So what are our next steps? We need to present the strategic research agenda. It's much more behind it. Yeah, there are many more things that I couldn't mention, like platform, mechanisms for innovation, for take-up, and so on. We need to meet with the national and EU research planners, funding, and policymakers. We need to address the public, which we are doing now with the white papers, and in 2 weeks with the strategic research agenda, mobilize more user industries, and then we have to realize the plan through research, innovation, and infrastructure programs. So what does it cost? One is often asked. Probably not more than 100 to 150 kilometer motorway. Yeah? So it could cost something like, compared to the general budgets, yeah, it's rather inexpensive, the language. Yeah? Even if it costs around a billion, it's still not as much as 200 miles of motorway. But the good thing is that no additional finances are needed in addition to the finances that are discussed anyway. Because these topics are core topics for Horizon 2020 and for another program that I hope Kimmo will mention, which is called Connecting Europe Facility, programs that in their core, by their dedication, yeah, should have very strong language technology in there. They will have language technology in there, but as much, it's up to us. Yeah, how good will our programs be and how convincing will we all be? And here I want to stress that what's called the small languages and the small countries really have some say. You cannot expect the big push necessarily to come from Germany in that sense. I wish it would, but I think if enough of the countries who worry about their language team up and help us in this decision process, it's going to happen. So the conclusion is then we have worked out the strategic research agenda that can put Europe ahead of its competitors, that has a chance to compete also with the big guys internationally, that will provide useful and attractive solutions to European society, and at the same time create huge business opportunities for European industry. And finish with a quote from my dentist in the United States. I had a dentist, I lived in the United States, who had a good way of saying that you should really floss your teeth very carefully. He said, only floss the teeth you want to keep. Yeah, so save time. And I think we should do the same thing with our languages. Only worry and spend money on the technology for the languages we want to keep. Yeah, so that will save us maybe some money. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.